This brings us to the third and final part of this documentary, Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection. See, Jesus came to this earth to die, to triumph over death and Satan, and to repair the relationship between God and us.
He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs, and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned every one to his own way. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people he was stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him, he hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors.
Many thousands of years before Jesus came to the earth, Isaiah prophesied how he would come and be killed for us, to take our punishment. This part of the story really begins with the Last Supper.
Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed. And he sent Peter and John, saying, Go, and prepare us the Passover, that we may eat. And they said unto him, Where wilt thou that we prepare? And he said unto them, Behold, when ye are entering into the city, there shall a man meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he entereth in. And ye shall say unto the good man of the house, The master saith unto thee, Where is the guest chamber, where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he shall show you a large upper room furnished. There make ready.
So Peter and John found everything exactly as Jesus said it would be. Big surprise, right? And they prepared everything for the Passover meal.
The Passover was celebrated as an observance of the Lord's passing over the Jews in Egypt when he slew all the firstborn. It was also one of the three pilgrimage festivals. All Jews were expected to travel to the temple in Jerusalem to observe the Passover. The Passover lasted 7 days, forbade consuming chametz, and required the removal of all chametz. The Passover was established by God, being the basis for the Hebrew calendar, and occurs on the first full moon after the spring equinox.
There were certain specific foods that were eaten for the Passover. Matzah, a flatbread made of flour and water, the Passover lamb, and wine, or unfermented grape juice, depending on who you're getting facts from.
And he said unto them, With desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof, until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup, and gave thanks, and said, Take this, and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine, until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread, and gave thanks, and brake it, and gave unto them, saying, This is my body which is given for you, this do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you.
Most churches have communion the first week of every month, though they generally read a portion of scripture from 1 Corinthians 11. Communion is just a way of remembering, or even a celebration of the Last Supper, and what Jesus did for us in giving his body to be broken and his blood to be spilled in our place. So while eating the supper, Jesus made it known that he knew one of them was going to betray him.
But behold, the hand of him that betrayeth me is with me on the table, and truly the Son of Man goeth, as it was determined, but woe unto that man by whom he is betrayed.
The betrayal wasn't some last-minute kind of thing. Judas had talked this over with the high priest and had bartered Jesus' life for 30 pieces of silver.
Then one of the 12, called Judas Iscariot, went unto the chief priests and said unto them, What will ye give me, and I will deliver him unto you? And they covenanted with him for 30 pieces of silver. And from that time he sought opportunity to betray him.
Jesus knew who was going to betray him. He knew when. He knew how it was going to happen. He knew it all. He is God, so he's all-knowing. So when he told Judas, That which thou doest, do quickly. The other disciples had no idea what he meant. Judas did, though, and he left. Shortly thereafter, Jesus and the rest of the disciples left the room and headed out for the Mount of Olives.
Of course, it would have been dark, but this is how I figure. If it's dark, you can't see this gorgeous landscape behind me. What's the point of coming out to the Garden of Gethsemane if you can't see it anyways? And then I figured, well, on the other hand, say I do come out when it's dark. I've got to bring lights, power. I don't know how I would power these really bright, you know, huge lights that don't make noise. I thought generator. I was, can't use a generator, it's going to make too much noise. You wouldn't hear me, you'd hear who wants to listen to generators running in the background to power the lights? So, I just opted and set to film in the daylight, when you can actually see the gorgeous garden. Jesus and his disciples frequented the garden a lot, so Judas knew their favorite spots, where they like to go to be alone, where they like to go to talk, where they like to go to do these different things. Judas knew that. He was part of the 12. He knew Jesus' habits and what kind of places he went to in the garden, depending on his mood and what was going on. Judas had gone to the temple, where he got a band of men and officers, which he now led to this very place.
Judas then, having received a band of men and officers from the chief priests and Pharisees, cometh thither with lanterns and torches and weapons. Jesus, therefore, knowing all things that should come upon him, went forth, and said unto them, Whom seek ye? They answered him, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus saith unto them, I am he. And Judas also, which betrayed him, stood with them. As soon then as he had said unto them, I am he, they went backward and fell to the ground. Then asked he them again, Whom seek ye? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus answered, I have told you that I am he. If therefore ye seek me, let these go their way. That the saying might be fulfilled which he spake, Of them which thou gavest me have I lost none.
The character of Jesus really shines through here. He knows exactly what this band wanted, who they wanted, why they were coming. And yet, what does he do? He asks that his disciples may be allowed to go peacefully. We also see the shock of this band of rough, tough guys. They literally fall backwards when Jesus tells them, I'm the one you're looking for. They like fell out of their sandals. They were so surprised. It's probable no one had ever said that before. I mean, come on. You have a band of guys coming to arrest you, ultimately to kill you. Of course, in most cases, you wouldn't know that. And you're telling them, oh yeah, I'm the guy you're looking for. Take me. Let these other guys go. No, you deny it. You say, I'm not the one you want. You're looking for somebody else. You clearly have the wrong person. Yeah, you need to find the right guy, but I'm not him. So, tally-ho, and then you run off real quick.
Then Simon Peter, having a sword, drew it, and smote the high priest's servant, and cut off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Then said Jesus unto Peter, Put up thy sword into the sheath. The cup which my father hath given me, shall I not drink it? Then the band and the captain and officers of the Jews took Jesus and bound him.
I learned a few things before flunking out of film school. Anyways, one is every successful blockbuster movie has a high-speed chase. Number two, it's got a pretty girl. Number three, there's a fight scene. And more often than that, there's an additional fourth thrown in for good measure, which is some explosions, some pyro. That kind of fun stuff. Everybody loves explosions and pyro. Well, I thought on this film, I've got one of those nailed. I've got a really cool fight scene. Volunteers these days. Seems they're not too keen about getting their ear cut off. So there goes the fight scene. Sorry, everybody. I was really hoping I could recruit some people from off the street who wouldn't mind coming out here. One with a sword,
one wearing a little robe kind of thing, you know, like they wore back then, bathrobes. And the one guy just had to cut the other guy's ear off. Easy! Yeah, it turns out not. Volunteers these days. What are they thinking? So Malchus's ear? Cut right off. But it was put back on. No more than a minute later, by Jesus. Even though these guys were coming out to arrest him, Jesus had compassion on them, and he literally picked up Malchus's bloody ear, put it back on his head, and healed him. If that's not love, I don't know what is.
And one of them smote the servant of the high priest and cut off his right ear. And Jesus answered and said, Suffer ye thus far. And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said unto the chief priests and captains of the temple and the elders, which were come against him, Be ye come out as against a thief with swords and staves? When I was daily with you in the temple, ye stretched forth no hands against me, but this is your hour and the power of darkness.
Disgusting? Yet beautiful. Disgusting because he was holding a bloody warm ear. But beautiful because even though these men were coming out to arrest him and ultimately kill him, he still had compassion on them. He still wanted the best for them. He still madly loved them. And he still healed Malchus's ear. We need to backtrack a bit. I got a little caught up in the story, and I missed some things. After arriving in the garden with his disciples, sans Judas, Jesus told them to pray, that they enter not into temptation. Then removed himself about a stone's cast, and prayed himself.
And he was withdrawn from them about a stone's cast, and kneeled down and prayed, saying, Father, if thou be willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thine be done. And there appeared an angel unto him from heaven, strengthening him. And being in an agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was as it were great drops of blood falling down to the ground.
Jesus knew what was going on. He knew that soon he was going to be tried and condemned, whipped, and crucified. His flesh didn't want to go through that kind of torture. So as he prayed, he begged his Father that somehow, some way, he might not have to go through this. But as he prayed, he asked, Not my will, but thine be done. The high priest's house wasn't just open to everyone. So most of our accounts are from John, who actually knew the high priest.
And Simon Peter followed Jesus, and so did another disciple. That disciple was known unto the high priest, and went in with Jesus into the palace of the high priest. But Peter stood at the door without. Then went out that other disciple, which was known unto the high priest, and spake unto her that kept the door, and brought in Peter.
Jesus' trial, if we can call it that, broke numerous laws. But so great was the religious leaders' hate for him, that they didn't care.
Early in the morning, before many people were awake, the religious leaders took Jesus from the high priest's house to the Hall of Judgment. Now, their actions here are kind of humorous, and we gotta take a look at what John records for us in the Bible.
Do you see that? The religious leaders wouldn't go into the judgment hall because that would defile them. However, the secret trial in the middle of the night that was completely against their law, they had no problem with.
Pilate actually had to come out and talk to the religious leaders as they wouldn't enter the judgment hall. He, like any good judge, asked what the condemned had done.
Pilate then went out unto them and said, What accusation bring you against this man? They answered and said unto him, If he were not a malefactor, we would not have delivered him up unto thee. Then said Pilate unto them, Take ye him, and judge him according to your law. The Jews therefore said unto him, It is not lawful for us to put any man to death, that the saying of Jesus might be fulfilled, which he spake, signifying what death he should die. Then Pilate entered into the judgment hall again, and called Jesus, and said unto him, Art thou the king of the Jews? Jesus answered him, Sayest thou this thing of thyself, or did others tell it thee of me? Pilate answered, Am I a Jew? Thine own nation and the chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done? Jesus answered, My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, that I should not be delivered to the Jews. but now is my kingdom not from hence? Pilate therefore said unto him, Art thou a king then? Jesus answered, Thou sayest that I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Every one that is of the truth heareth my voice. Pilate saith unto him, What is truth? And when he had said this, he went out again unto the Jews, and saith unto them, I find in him no fault at all.
It's really no surprise that Pilate found no fault in Jesus, being perfect and sinless. Jesus, that is. Pilate was just a man, and a sinner, as are you and I. Pilate wanted to keep the Jews happy. I mean, the last thing any leader wants, especially a foreign one, is any reason for insurrection.
But ye have a custom, that I should release unto you one at the Passover. Will ye therefore that I release unto you the King of the Jews? They cried they all again, saying, Not this man, but Barabbas. Now Barabbas was a robber.
Pilate could have kept Jesus from being killed, but again, he wanted to keep the people happy.
Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe and said, Hail, King of the Jews! And they smote him with their hands. Pilate therefore went forth again and saith unto them, Behold, I bring him forth to you, that ye may know that I find no fault in him.
Scourging was performed with a Roman flagrum, sometimes called a flagellum, which is slightly similar to a kettle nine tails. However, the ends of the lashes were tipped with small bone or rock fragments. It was not uncommon for a person to die from blood loss and infection after receiving a scourging. It's said that sometimes the flagrum was dipped in fresh goat's blood, being used to promote infection. Roman flagrums could have from 3 to 12 straps. Scourging was an extreme way to get people to tell the truth, or what the torturers wanted to hear anyways.
Pilate was convinced that Jesus had done nothing wrong, and was guilty of nothing warranting death. So he called for water, and washed his hands, symbolizing that he was innocent of this man's death.
When Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water, and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person, see ye to it. Then answered all the people, and said, His blood be on us, and on our children.
Pilate had Jesus scourged, but that didn't appease the religious leaders. They wanted him crucified. So, after calling for water and washing his hands, Pilate commanded that it be done as they wanted. Initially, Jesus was carrying, well, more dragging the cross. But after the scourging he received, and the blood he'd lost from the crown of thorns, he physically didn't have the strength to carry on.
Crosses were made out of wood, rough cut and rugged. Because they were used for killing people, they weren't made comfortable, because they were made to be torturous. Depending on the age of the wood of the cross, it could have weighed from 1 to 200 pounds. The Roman Empire borrowed the idea from the Phoenicians, who borrowed it from some other group. We're not exactly sure who first came up with the idea.
The Roman soldiers pressed Simon, a Cyrenian, into service and made him carry Jesus' cross. Now, Jesus wasn't the only man being crucified that day. There were two others.
And there were also two other malefactors led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place, which is called Calvary, there they crucified him and the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left.
Crucifixion, the cruelest way to die. Nobody was spared from this horror. Men, women, children, and even infants met their death via crucifixion. This was the torture of tortures. Nails were driven through the hands and feet, though they were placed in such locations that they didn't pierce the bones, but rather went between them. The condemned hung on their nails until they died.
Jesus was crucified between two common criminals, one on the left side and one on the right. While hanging on their respective crosses, the criminals and Jesus had an interesting conversation.
And one of the malefactors which were hanged railed on him, saying, If thou be Christ, save thyself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, Dost not thou fear God, seeing thou art in the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man hath done nothing amiss. And he said unto Jesus, Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. And Jesus said unto him, Verily I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise.
Jesus had a sign on the cross, above his head, written in Greek, Latin, and Hebrew, and it read, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews.
And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. This title then read many of the Jews, for the place where Jesus was crucified was nigh to the city, and it was written in Hebrew, and Greek, and Latin. Then said the chief priests of the Jews to Pilate, Write not the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews. Pilate answered, What I have written, I have written. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments, and made four parts, to every soldier a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top throughout.
So Jesus and the two criminals were hanging on their crosses, waiting to die, when suddenly, around the sixth hour, bam, it got dark. And it stayed that way for 3 hours.
And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Some of them that stood there, when they had heard that, said, This man calleth for Elias. And straightway one of them ran, and took a sponge, and filled it with vinegar, and put it on a reed, and gave him to drink. The rest said, Let be, let us see whether Elias will come to save him. Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of saints which slept arose, and came out of the graves after the resurrection, and went into the holy city, and appeared unto many.
The temple veil was torn in two when Jesus died, as if torn by an invisible hand.
The temple veil separated the Holy of Holies from the holy place. Only the high priest could visit the Holy of Holies, and only once a year. Records vary on the size of the veil, but Josephus said it was 60 feet tall and 4 inches thick. The veil was torn from top to bottom, and signified that we no longer needed the high priest to make atonement for our sins, but that we could come directly to God.
It's funny how the Jews could kill a righteous man, and in the same day worry about bodies hanging on the crosses for the Sabbath. Anyways, they went and asked Pilate if they couldn't get the criminals' legs broken and have them taken away.
The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation that the bodies should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was a high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken, and that they might be taken away. Then came the soldiers, and brake the legs of the first, and of the other which was crucified with him.
Breaking the legs of people might sound odd. They're already being crucified. They're dying. Why break their legs? Well, breaking their legs causes all of their body's weight to hang on their arms. This pulls on muscles in the chest, which connect to the lungs, making it difficult to breathe. Essentially, breaking their legs causes them to suffocate and die a whole lot faster.
But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was dead already, they brake not his legs. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. And he that saw it bare record, and his record is true. And he knoweth that he saith true, that ye might believe. For these things were done, that the scripture should be fulfilled, A bone of him shall not be broken. And again another scripture saith, They shall look on him whom they pierced.
This totally debunks the idea that Jesus' bones were broken when he was crucified. They didn't smash his leg bones. His hand bones weren't shattered when they nailed him to the cross. Not a bone of his body was broken. So the Bible says, people, come on.
So Jesus was dead. The priests wanted his body off the cross before the evening, because it was coming up upon the Sabbath quickly. And there was a man who wanted Jesus' body.
And after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, besought Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus, and Pilate gave him leave. He came, therefore, and took the body of Jesus. And there came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night, and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pound weight. Then took they the body of Jesus, and wound it in linen clothes with the spices, as the manner of the Jews is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified there was a garden, and in the garden a new sepulchre, wherein was never man yet laid. There laid they Jesus therefore because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulchre was nigh at hand.
So Jesus' body was in the grave, and had been all day. The priests and Pharisees were worried that some of Jesus' followers might come and take the body and claim that he had risen, as he said he would.
Now the next day, that followed the day of the preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees came together unto Pilate, saying, Sir, we remember that that deceiver said, while he was yet alive, After 3 days I will rise again. Command, therefore, that the sepulchre be made sure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night, and steal him away, and say unto the people, He is risen from the dead. So the last error shall be worse than the first. Pilate said unto them, Ye have a watch, go your way, make it as sure as you can. So they went, and made the sepulchre sure, sealing the stone, and setting a watch.
Pilate gave a watch, which is nothing more than a group of soldiers, to guard over the tomb, make sure no one came in and stole the body, or messed with the tomb in general. Nobody messed with Roman soldiers. They were the best of the best. If you messed with them, you didn't live to tell about it. The Roman guard was probably 10 to 30 highly trained soldiers. Now, one thing you gotta know about Roman guards is they didn't desert their post for anything. A Roman soldier that put down his weapons, fell asleep, or deserted his post while on guard duty was executed. This is why the Roman soldiers were such a formidable foe, was their strict rules and their complete adherence to their commander's orders.
In the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulchre. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning, and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him the keepers did shake, and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, Fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come, see the place where the Lord lay, and go quickly, and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. And behold, he goeth before you into Galilee, there shall ye see him. Lo, I have told you. And they departed quickly from the sepulchre with fear and great joy, and did run to bring his disciples word.
Guys, Jesus rose from the dead. He's alive evermore, seated at the right hand of God, making intercession for us. Death's been defeated. The grave couldn't hold him down. The story of the disciples stealing the body was made up by the priests and their council.
Now when they were going, behold, some of the watch came into the city, and showed unto the chief priests all the things that were done. And when they were assembled with the elders, and had taken counsel, they gave large money unto the soldiers, saying, Say ye, his disciples came by night, and stole him away while we slept. And if this come to the governor's ears, we will persuade him, and secure you. So they took the money, and did as they were taught, and this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day.
This video project has been a ton of fun. I'm so glad you guys stick around. But you know what? It's not over yet. After Jesus rose, he appeared to his disciples numerous times.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he was seen of Cephas, then of the 12. After that, he was seen of above 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep.
Before Jesus left this earth to go into heaven, he left us this one final command.
Go ye therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you alway, even unto the end of the world. Amen.
So Jesus lived a sinless life. He was crucified and buried, then rose from the dead and ascended into heaven.
And he led them out as far as to Bethany, And he lift up his hands, and blessed them. And it came to pass, while he blessed them, he was parted from them, and carried up into heaven. And they worshipped him, and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and were continually in the temple, praising and blessing God. Amen.